Well, hi there, and welcome once again to In Search of Christianity, brought to you by Bible Talk. We're just so blessed that you can join us as we spend time together in God's wonderful, amazing Word.
Amen to that.
That we might have a greater revelation, a greater understanding, a greater knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. That's why we're together. We're going to get right into this. Last week, we talked about discipleship. And the importance. I must have ships on my mind here. The importance of being a true disciple and understanding what discipleship is. Because it has an impact on everything in your life as a Christian. And this program, what I want to do is I want to go a little bit further. I said that we were going to get into the Sermon on the Mount. And indeed we will shortly. But knowing what a disciple is prepares you for that.
Yes.
But I thought to myself as I was praying this week, there's another thing that we have to get into to be prepared to hear that word from Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And that's going from the process of revelation to knowledge to understanding to wisdom.
Yes.
And that's what we're going to get into in this particular program. Mm-hmm. All right? So I hope you're ready, and I'm going to ask Brother Mark if you'll ask God's blessing on our time together in His Word.
Oh, Lord, we're about to get in Your Word,
yes.
And we just thank You for it. Lord, it says in Your Word, You're the Prince of Peace,
mm-hmm.
And we just thank You for that peace.
Yes.
No matter what our day was like, and usually they're trying down here, we just thank You for the peace that You and Your Word bring. And just enlighten us with Your Word and let us incorporate it in our lives with peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And it's a peace that passes understanding.
Yes.
Because it's not a peace that the world can give you. Amen. Hallelujah.
This is not a peaceful time.
All right. I'm going to start with revelation. Because I think that we don't have, by and large, a good understanding of revelation. Okay? Revelation, the word that's most commonly used, almost consistently throughout the Old Testament, the Hebrew word is galah, and it means to denude, to strip.
All right. Okay.
But it's translated in the King James 16 times as reveal, 34 times as uncover,
mm-hmm.
29 times as discover, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And in the New Testament, in the Greek, the word is apokalupto, where we get our word apocalypse. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why the last book of the Bible is often called the Apocalypse or the Book of Revelation, okay? And the word there means, the word apokalupto means to reveal, but it literally means to uncover.
Okay.
And in the Hebrew, that word galah literally means to uncover or discover, as I mentioned,
mm-hmm.
okay? So if you understand that, then understand this. Something that is revealed was always there.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. Right.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
You're uncovering it. You're taking off what covers it.
Right.
All right? It's there already, but you're not seeing it.
Mm-hmm.
So revelation, I use the example, I don't know if it's a good example to use, but like in The Wizard of Oz,
mm-hmm.
where towards the end of the movie, you know, if you know the story, the Wizard of Oz, he's behind a curtain operating this machine, is putting off this magnificent over there, hiding behind a curtain. And the main players, Dorothy and her three friends and her dog Toto, the dog runs over and pulls the curtain aside,
mm-hmm.
and they look over and they see this man behind the curtain. And he's saying, don't pay any attention to the man behind the curtain.
Right. Yes.
So they don't understand what's happening instantly, all right?
Right.
The man has been revealed.
But there's no understanding.
But they don't know what's going on, and they don't understand what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
All right? We have revelation.
Yes.
In the beginning was the Word. Jesus was revealed.
Yes.
From the very, very beginning.
Absolutely right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. But something was covering that revelation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Something was covering Him. It was my 33rd birthday when I had a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, I will tell you that all through my life, mm-hmm. you know, I had spiritual glimpses of the Lord mm-hmm. that I just pretty much ignored, all right? But it was uncovered on that day that I had that radical encounter with him. What covered him? What covered, what was hiding Jesus from me?
Your sin.
Well, the world.
The world. Lies. The world and the things of the world. I mean, which includes man-made religion.
Okay.
All right, think about this. Because I didn't say I wasn't wasn't religious, mm-hmm. but I didn't know Jesus.
Right.
I never had a revelation of who Jesus Christ truly was. Paul wrote to the church in Colossae, to the Colossians, and he said, "See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception, according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ." And he went on in verse 21 to 23 and said, "Do not." What they're saying is, do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, which all refer to things destined to perish with use, in accordance with the commandments and teachings of men. These are matters which have, to be sure, the appearance of wisdom in self-made religion and self-abasement and severe treatment of the body, but have no value against fleshly indulgence. In other words, it's this teaching of men, this self-made religion, that was hiding Jesus Christ, the true revelation of Jesus Christ from me. Now let me say this. The book of Revelation is not the revelation. The Bible is the revelation, and what John received on the island of Patmos is a part of that revelation. From Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, God has revealed himself to us. He has revealed his plan for man to us. He has revealed Christ to us through that. So we've had this total revelation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is there revelation to come? Well, yeah, Jesus, when he appears again, when we see him as he is, that's but otherwise, you know, people are always saying, well, I got this revelation. Trust me, God has given us the revelation. What you get all of a sudden is a flash, you get an understanding.
Yes.
All right? Mm-hmm. There's knowing. Now, this may be a poor example, but it pops into my head.
Okay.
If somebody came here and put a wrapped gift on this table,
mm-hmm.
say, oh, that's nice. Mm-hmm. But you don't know, first of all, you got to know who it's for.
Right.
Now, the gift that was given to us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever will have eternal life. So God has put the gift down. He has told us who it's for.
Yes.
For whosoever will, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when you remove the wrapping, now you see what the present is.
Mm-hmm.
So when you remove the wrapping from this, you see Jesus Christ. That is the gift that the Father has given us. When the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, it should have become clear, right? But there's knowing about him,
mm-hmm.
things about God,
mm-hmm.
and there is knowing him.
Yes, that relationship.
A relationship.
Mm-hmm.
There's knowing and there's knowing.
Mm-hmm.
You may want to write that one down. But the fact is, God says that one of the first times that word know appears in the Bible is in the garden, or after the garden, actually. When Adam and Eve are outside the gates of the garden, and it says that Adam knew Eve, and she conceived and bore a son.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know many translations have eliminated that word know, but that's what it says in the Hebrew. And the Hebrew word is yada.
Mm-hmm.
And this is important,
yes.
because that word comes from the Hebrew word yad, which is a word for hand, an open hand, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So what it means is it's an intimate knowledge. It comes from touching. It comes from intimacy. Our relationship, lots of people know that there is a God.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of people know something about God. But this level of intimacy, the knowledge that we're supposed to have of God, is an intimate knowledge. He's, you know, we're his beloved. He's my beloved and he is mine, right? We're supposed to have an intimate relationship, a loving relationship with the Lord.
Yes.
So you have to have a knowledge of God that comes from, what does he desire? He wants to walk hand in hand with you.
Mm-hmm.
That's the kind of closeness that he wants, yes. Right? You can just, I can open up that gift. So when I open up the gift, I take the paper off it, and there's a box, and I open the box, and I see the gift, and the gift is an iPad. Mm. Ah, that's nice. Now, I'm sure pretty much everybody has some kind of knowledge of what an iPad is, or tablets, right? But that doesn't mean you know anything about them. Yeah. A lot of people, you know, will be getting or are getting iPads or tablets, and they know they have some kind of knowledge about it, but it's not an intimate knowledge. That comes from use,
right.
From touching it, right?
Yes.
That's what God wants us to get to, is that place of intimate knowledge with Him. Because you may know it, or you may get somebody may give you a tablet, and maybe the only thing you'll ever use it for is to play silly little games.
Mm.
That's because you don't understand what it can do.
Right.
I mean, that little tablet, you know, for example, on mine, you know, I've got so many different versions of the Bible and Bible study material. It's a movie camera. It's a video editing thing. It's so many things. But the more understanding you have of it, the more useful it becomes in your life, and the more effect it has in your life. So you've got to grow and have that understanding. Jesus said, when he was teaching and there was a crowd around him, he said to them, hear and understand.
Yes.
The command of God is to understand. Why is that so important? Because he went on to say, remember, he talked in parables. In Matthew 13, all of the different parables.
Yes.
And the disciples, you know, they said, why are you always talking to people in parables? And Jesus said, hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is the one on whom seed was sown beside the road. Matthew 13, 18, and 19.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have understanding, anything you know is going to be snatched away from you.
Yes.
That understanding is what makes it the reality of your life. Jesus said to the Sadducees, you are mistaken, not understanding the scriptures nor the power of God in Matthew 22. He was saying, these are the religious leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, you don't have understanding. To the Pharisees. Now the Pharisees, they knew scriptures backwards and forwards and backwards. That's the truth.
Yes.
They could literally do that. I mean, I've known guys, when I did graduate work in a seminary, I mean, I knew guys who had that kind of knowledge of the scripture. The problem was, you can have that knowledge of the scripture without knowing the Lord who is the Word. The Pharisees knew the scripture, but they didn't recognize the Word of God when He walked through their midst.
Mm-hmm.
You can know the scriptures without knowing the Word.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I said this last week, if you know the scriptures but don't have the Holy Spirit, you're going to be a Pharisee.
Mm-hmm.
You see, because that led them to believe and mistake the teaching and understanding of men for the wisdom and knowledge of God.
Mm-hmm.
I use the example of the Sabbath. You know, Jesus had to say to them, the Sabbath was made for man,
yes.
Not man for the Sabbath.
Right.
The Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. That's in Mark chapter 2, by the way, verses 27 and 28. But the thing about that is, they knew that there was a Sabbath, that God said to keep holy. They knew that.
Mm-hmm.
But because they didn't have an understanding of it,
they leaned on their own understanding.
Well, then exactly, and what Alice is saying, you know, it says in Proverbs 3, not to lean on your own understanding,
mm-hmm.
but to trust in God.
Right.
So what happens is, when you don't have, you can have some that kind of knowledge, but when you don't have an understanding of it, you're not going to have wisdom to use it properly.
Right.
So the Pharisees who knew the law were using it to oppress and burden people.
Yes.
Rather than to set them free.
Amen.
But the purpose of the Word of God is to set you free.
Yes.
Jesus came into this world to set you free from the bondage of sin.
Yes.
Not to put you into more bondage, right?
Right?
And, you know, Jesus would say in the Sermon on the Mount, over and over, you have heard it said, but I say to you. Where did they hear it said?
From the Pharisees.
From the religious leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And what they were hearing was scripture or the teaching of the man.
Mm-hmm.
But without an understanding of God's Word.
Right.
Disciples get understanding.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
Because as the disciples are having a discussion with him about the parables, They said to him, "Why do you speak them in parables?" And Jesus answered, he said, "To you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been granted." So if you are one of those disciples, the remnant, the bondservants of Christ, God will give you understanding. Why do people not understand the Word of God? Well, I'm going to tell you one of the important reasons that they don't. Think about when Jesus said to his disciples, he said, "My teaching is not mine, but his who sent me. If anybody is willing to do his will, he will know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak for myself." John 7, 16 and 17. Somebody who is not willing to do God's word will be deceived and confused and not understand. This is what we talked about last week. If you are a disciple, you are that person filled with the love of God, driven by the Holy Spirit who indwells you, and you do the Word of God.
Yes.
You don't just hear the Word of God, you do it. This is what James said. James said, "Prove yourselves doers of the Word and not merely hearers who delude themselves." Because if you're hearing the Word but not doing the Word, you're deluded. And you don't have an understanding of God's purpose of His Word. It's not so you can go out. You know, it says that knowledge puffs up, but love edifies. You know why? Because there are people who know Scripture. Mm-hmm. But it never builds up. It puffs up.
Right. And the goal of our instruction
is love.
Love.
Absolutely.
Not self-edification.
Absolutely. Right. So, you know, we come together in the Word. The purpose of this is not so you become a Bible scholar. The purpose of this is not so you can impress people with how much you know about Scripture. The purpose of this is that you can be a doer of God's Word.
Yes.
Because that is the reason you are here on earth.
And that's the tool we have, is the Word. That's the power.
It is the tool. But you have to understand something. I mean, you know, why has God formed the church the way He has? Why has He put in the church apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of service, so that we can fulfill the ministry that God has called us to? What is that ministry? Well, you know, I know I've shared this in the past, but it's like I've done a lot of pastors' conferences, and I was teaching pastors, and I would say to the pastors, you know, "Do you believe that God wants to bless you as much as He possibly can?" Mm-hmm. And of course, Lord, let me ask you, do you believe that God wants to bless you as much as He possibly can?
Trick question.
Of course.
Because the answer is no. If He wanted to bless you as much as He possibly could right this moment, you would drop dead of a heart attack, a bolt of lightning would come through the roof, or the North Koreans would attack and an A-bomb would land on your bean. And you would go fizz straight to the throne of God.
Let me ask you another question. Does God want to bless the church as much as possible?
Well, the church
is
people.
The body, yeah.
Right. But the reason why you're still here is you need to bless somebody else.
Well, that's
and if you were gone, then you couldn't
do
the work.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Paul said to live is Christ,
to die is gain.
The reason He has not taken you to be physically with Him now, it's because He has purpose for you being here.
His plan.
And the purpose for you being here is not so that you somehow get perfected and worthy to get into the gates of heaven. Because the righteousness that you have is His. He has made you righteous by His atoning work on the cross. Mm-hmm. So the only reason you are here is to represent Him,
yes,
to touch other lives.
Absolutely.
Starting with the household of God. And with the household of God, we are supposed to be working together in unity to be a blessing to one another, that we might be in the world those ambassadors for Christ, mm-hmm, bringing the knowledge of Christ into every place.
Yes.
That's our purpose here. So, you know what? That should be a blessing to you.
Mm-hmm.
All right? But being here is less of a blessing than being there. That's a fact. And it's a fact you should recognize, all right? Okay. After His resurrection, Jesus went and He walked through the wall. He's in the house with His disciples.
Mm-hmm.
And He said to them, These are my words, which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And it says, then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. Luke 24:44-45. God desires that we understand. Throughout Proverbs, it talks about how we should cry out, how we should aspire, how we should seek these things, the knowledge of God, the wisdom that God, only God can give, and the understanding that comes from God. Okay? We have to have that. We have to desire that. If you are one of you, be honest with yourself. It says, let a man examine himself. If, that woman, too. If you're in a place where you're saying, well, I just don't understand, make sure that in your heart you've looked and you have a willingness to do what the Word says. Because if you don't have that willingness to do, it's going to fuzzy up, it's going to fog your understanding. Yes. It's going to distort your understanding of God's Word. Be realistic and make sure that, you know, and don't, it doesn't have to be this thing, well, okay, you know, well, I'd like to. He has given you the Holy Spirit. The very power of God dwells within you. So cry out to Him, because He will give you the power to do the things. He will never call you to do anything that He does not equip you to do. That was what we saw as the model of the ruler of the world in when Moses was sent into Egypt. Remember, the Pharaoh had called the people of God to make bricks, but then refused to give them what they required to make them. They had to make bricks without straw. They had to get their own, yes. Right? Mm-hmm. That's the ruler of the world. God doesn't do that. Whatever He calls you to do, He will equip you to do and empower you to do. Amen. Do you have understanding? No, we're all supposed to have it, and we all have to grow in it. That's a fact. You can understand a lot of things. I mean, you understand electricity? Very few of us do. He's an electrician. Mm-hmm. But I'll tell you, not even he has a full knowledge and understanding of electricity.
Right. I'll agree to that.
Well, because it just the truth. I mean, you know certain things about it. It's been revealed to you since you were young that if you go over and throw the light switch, lights go on.
Right.
Da, da, da. That doesn't mean you understand the working of it. I mean, you know, I can go over and throw the switch. I have no idea where the power is coming from. I don't know if it's coming from a nuclear power plant or it's coming from a waterfall someplace or wind turbines. I don't understand, and I don't understand all of the workings of it. Mm-hmm. Okay?
You don't have to.
No, I don't need to. But I have the revelation and I have a working knowledge of it. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. How much do you know? But then it gets into the issue of wisdom. Like I said, if somebody gave you a tablet, okay, and it's new to you, so you grow in your knowledge of it, you understand what it's capable of doing, but it takes wisdom to use it properly. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can use that tablet to communicate with brothers and sisters around the world. You can use it to put Bibles on it and study the Word and tools to study it more and more. Or you can sit there all day and watch pornography on it. Mm. It's the same tool. Requires basically the same knowledge of how to work it, but wisdom will decide what you use it for. So where does wisdom come from? Well, I'm glad you asked. I'm going to read to you from James chapter 1, verses 2 to 8. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But he must ask in faith, without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, because you see it works something. And what it works, it leads to understanding.
Mm-hmm.
It leads to wisdom.
Now, there's wisdom from above.
There is wisdom, and this says it later in James. There is wisdom from above. That's what God gives. Mm-hmm. And then there is wisdom that is earthly, natural, and demonic. Now, it doesn't say that there are three different wisdoms. It says that there is wisdom that is earthly, natural, and demonic.
Well, there'd be four different wisdoms. Godly, and then earthly, natural, and
demonic. No, you know what I'm saying?
But
there's only two.
There's only two.
Yes. Your wisdom either comes from God or it comes from the world.
The earthly, natural, and demonic are three adjectives for one other wisdom.
For the worldly wisdom.
Right.
Absolutely. That's where it comes from. If your wisdom is not coming from God, then
it
is earthly, natural, and demonic. I mean, that's what the Word of God says.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't believe the Word, well, what am I supposed to say? But that started with, you know, we count it all joy when we encounter various trials. Paul says we exult in our tribulations because it does the same thing. It's a process.
Mm-hmm.
That process leads to hope. Okay?
Hope doesn't disappoint.
Paul wrote to Timothy, and he said, you know, we're supposed to study. He said, study or be diligent to present yourselves approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. But avoid worldly and empty chatter, for it will lead to further ungodliness. You got to work at this. You got to be diligent. You got to persevere. You got to press on. This doesn't come. I mean, what's happened? We live here in the Western world in a fast food generation where you anticipate that your favorite teacher or your pastor, he'll get on his face before God and study all week long, and then come on Sunday and you will receive everything you need by hearing him for 15 or 20 minutes. No, that is not God's plan. God's plan is that you abide in his word, that you study his word, that you are diligent to be in his word, that you are devoted to prayer, which is conversation with him about his word. Because this is the font, that's the source of all of these things, the knowledge that you need. He reveals himself in his word. And then you get knowledge from there, knowledge that you need. You'll get understanding from his word. And you will get wisdom from his word. But that's the only place it's going to come from. And it's not a matter of going to, you know, a seminary. Prayerfully receive what I'm saying. It's not about prayerfully going to a seminary and learning, you know, all of these things. Because, like I said, sometimes knowledge doesn't have anything but the puff up.
Mm-hmm.
All right? It's not what you receive from men. Now, God can use men to pass stuff to you. I hope so, because that's, what am I doing here otherwise?
The teacher's there.
But you have to hear from the Lord, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
Yes.
You got to hear from God. And that is devoting yourself to prayer, having conversation with God about all that you are studying and praying about.
Those apostles and prophets and pastors that God provides is only to prime the pump.
Well, it's supposed to stimulate it's supposed to stimulate and encourage your conversations with the Lord. And that's what I pray that happens through what we're doing. And next week, we are going to get into the Sermon on the Mount, which is Christianity.
Yes.
It is true Christianity, and it is training in righteousness. And Father, we just thank you that you spoke through your Son, Jesus Christ, after his night in prayer, that he would train us in righteousness, that he would give us that word that we need to move and have understanding of your love for us and the love that we are supposed to pour out to others and touch others with. Lord, I just praise you and thank you for your Holy Spirit that you have given us to lead us into all truth. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' precious name, Lord God. Amen.
Far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. But I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners.